Okay, thank you. So what I'm going to speak is mostly about the points of processing of steel, so thermomechanical processing. So I took this slide from the Nippon Steels, but of course this applies for many other companies. So you have usually the after the casting process, the continuous casting, where you have here thermomechanical forces applied to the continuous casting. Then you may have a hot roll mill and a cold roll mill, and a lot of heat treatments in between. So change in the microstructure, change in the phase transformation, change in everything but the chemistry, hopefully. And with this also the mechanical properties. So the motivation of my talk is what do we expect from the models to deliver for this processing. So in the base case, what we want is to have the chemical composition of the workpiece, and after using our model that I called for sake of just only example, X ultimative, this would be the best model that we could have, to have at the end the mechanical properties, the geometry, and the physical properties of the product. Of course, the microstructure that is related to the mechanical properties. And in this model, we should simulate the process. We should be able to make variations in the process parameter, like temperature and time and deformation. And we should be able to also optimize the process in terms of energy that we use or temperatures to obtain the product that that we wish. We usually go in this direction from the thermomechanical processing applied to workpiece. We can describe the behavior of materials. So this is an example for titanium alloys, where you can see that with different starting microstructures and the different strains, then you get different grain size, for example. So this is the level of grain size. And then you get the distribution, or may get the distribution of the product in the final product. Of course, most interesting is to apply so-called reverse engineering, that we say, from this starting product, what process should I apply with which chemical composition? So this is what we are all looking for many years, and not only we. I mean, when I say we, I say the whole scientific community. In our approach, what we do is we apply thermomechanical process. We get the knowledge from the experiments. The knowledge means not only the data, but also the knowledge of the process itself, that are happening at different temperatures and deformations, and also the mechanical properties. And then we apply our unified physical model in integrate them into finite element simulations and try to calculate the performance in service, or to predict the performance in service. The concept that we are dealing with since many years is this concept of unified physical model, and this is what I want to explain here in this slide, what is what we are looking for. So we have seen from with our studies and with the literature review many, many years, that we can describe the plastic deformation, which is done at constant temperature and constant strain rate. We can describe the dislocation, or there are many groups describing the dislocation creep, which is given at constant temperature and constant stresses. And also we may be able to describe stress relaxation. It's a bit more tricky because the deformation is constant, not the plastic deformation, and the temperature. And then we have the evolutions of the different variables. So for the plastic deformation, we obtain the flow curves. For dislocation creep, we obtain the creep curves. And for the relaxation of stresses, we obtain the changes of the stresses over the time. We also have seen that different alloys behave similarly, and this similarity is given by the Stockingfold energy. This means that materials that have similar Stockingfold energy behaves the same. If we have materials with very high stocking forward energies like aluminium alloys or ferritic steels or beta titanium alloys, they will deform by forming cells and subgrains, and they will not, for example, discontinuously recrystallize. But this is the opposite for materials forming with low stocking forward energy. So we can make group of two big groups of materials and try to find models that can be used for these two groups of materials. We also are seeking for models that can describe in one model the dislocation creep, plastic deformation, and stress relaxation, since they are phenomena that can be modeled using the same approach. For this, we need to describe the microstructure consistently and without any gaps. So we need to describe the microstructure evolution from the very first beginning till the end, and also during the service as well. So I'm going to show now today only this part of the plastic deformation. And for this, I just plot very simply what do we understand for a flow curve. So flow curve is the stress over the strain. We have the material starts flowing at the yield strength. And then we have some strain hardening. We may reach a peak flow, and then we have a softening. So the softening can oppose to the strain hardening, and we can also have some steady state, for example. And the softening occurs dynamically due to recovery. So I put into brackets what is really relevant for steels. So we may have that the ferrite phase undergoes dynamic recovery. And if we strain a bit more, then we will go into continuous dynamic recrystallization. The austenitic phase, since it's a low stocking forward energy material phase usually, it will undergo discontinuous dynamic recrystallization, which means formation of pores, crystals, and then growth. And then we may have also phase transformation that occurs dynamically. But also the flow localization produces softening. This is independent on the material, more dependent on the shape of the geometry of the sample or geometry of the workpiece that produces the stress triaxiality. We may have also friction and temperature distributions and so on. And I'm going to speak today about strain hardening, shear and deformation bends, recovery, and continuous recrystallization. So we have seen, as I said, that high stocking forward materials undergo dynamic recovery and continuous dynamic recrystallization, aluminium, ferritic steels, beta titanium alloys, moly, and that we, if we get very large deformations, as I said, we go into continuous dynamic recrystallization. What is the meaning of this, or how can we model or imagine this microstructure evolution? We go again to the stress strain curve, and we start with the material that may have a grade of recrystallization or can be fully recrystallized. Here in black, you can see the high angle grain boundaries, the mobile dislocation densities. We are working with the dislocation density, which means dislocation lines over the volume. And we may have also immobile dislocations, which are these here, immobilized by obstacles, and tight pores that are also immobile. And when we start deforming, we start forming low angle grain boundaries. So this can also be described by dislocations. Then these are the walls dislocations. And when we go on, then the subgrain are completely formed. And then we may have the formation of high angle grain boundaries by rotation of these low angle grain boundaries and accumulation of dislocations, until at the end we have 100% of continuously recrystallized material. It means that we have a 100% fraction of high angle grain boundaries. From the microstructure models, as I said, we are working with dislocation densities. Of course, if you start in the literature review, you will see that there are works done by Cox and Making, and describing one dislocation density over the whole volume of the material. This is, of course, a model like the one that we are using, but a bit more simple. And every single dislocation produces a stress field. So this stress field is then the stress field that is related to the resistance of the material. There are other models based on three dislocation densities, again, dipoles and mobiles. So the mobiles are the one that can move. And all of them, and these are at the boundaries or even at the walls. And these ones all produce different strain fields, as you can see, and therefore different resistance to dislocation movement. And you may also find in the literature the work of Montellier on continuous dynamic regularization, where you can also, this model also describes the boundaries surfaces, so high angle ground boundaries and low angle ground boundary surfaces. And then you have to describe how this evolution of the dislocations occur over a time or over a deformation. The most well-known is the Cox-Making model, and this Cox-Making model describes just formation of dislocations and recovery of dislocations or annihilation of dislocations, everything that comes into a reduction of dislocations without speaking much about the process itself, the phenomena itself. If you go to the models that there are in the creep modeling, you will see that the guys, so Goniam and colleagues, are a bit more advanced, and they were using something called dislocation reactions, which means what happens with dislocations that are at the walls, what are they doing? Are they interacting with the other dislocations, like mobiles are transforming into walls, and so on and so forth. So instead of using the approach of Cox-Making for hot deformation, we use the approach of Goniam. So now I'm following with the colors. Color red is Goniam and color blue is Cox-Making. So you can see for the mobile dislocations, we have to assume starting mobile dislocation density, or also can be calculated, but it's a constant over the deformation. While in the Goniam, you can see that you have the contributions of Frank Rizzo's emission from wall, absorption into walls, climb recovery, dynamic recovery. Here you can see the interaction with the other dislocation densities, and you can see the annihilation or disappearance due to the movement of high angle ground boundaries by continuous dynamic regularization. So you can also see that we have glide velocities and we have climb velocities. Please remember that the climb velocities are controlled by diffusion and therefore these are temperature dependent. So the same for the immobile dislocations, where here it was only production and reduction of dislocations, and here we have a full description. And the same for the boundaries or boundary dislocation density or just the boundaries, where we apply also the concepts of Goniam as well. Then we need finally the constitutive equations to calculate the flow stresses. And for this, as you can see here, there's a factor in front of the walls because the walls produce a very small strain field and we have to account for this. You can also account for the half edge, and this is related to the yield strength. In the case of Cox-Making, we may use the evolution of the strain like this. In the case of Goniam, we account also for the elastic and the plastic strain. So then we went to take a look at the results. You see, this is for titanium alloys, it's not for steels. You see that we may have also some softening here. We are working in two phases. Let's take a look here where we have only one phase. You have to apply the same set of equations for the other phase in the case of allotropic materials. And you can see that from respect to the modeling predictions, both models are similar. One, it's a bit more complex. And if you take a look also to some microstructure evolution. This is the most interesting part for us, to predict the diameter of grain size and of subgrain size. So you can see in red the grain size, and in black the subgrain size. They're meeting each other when we have a continuous dynamic recrystallization finished. You can also see the dislocation densities and also the fraction of high-angle grain boundaries that also can be correlated with the grade of recrystallization, for example. It's a different way of counting for recrystallization. But you can imagine that when you have 100% of the fraction of high-angle grain boundary, you have reached 100% of recrystallization. So the predictions are a bit similar, but why doing this with such a complex model? And the answer is because we can also understand what, or we can understand from our model and explain what is happening in the material. So here, what I'm showing is every single line represents, or every single curve represents one term in the equation of Goniam. All plus means there are production terms, and all minus means there are terms where dislocations disappear. And we can also see here glide and climb. So it seems to be that for these high strain rates, the glide is prominent with respect to the climb. But while when we decrease the strain rates, they are more or less equal. So what is this giving us an idea? This is giving us an idea of the mechanisms behind the dislocation movement and the microstructure arrangement for different conditions. Of course, you can use the same model for creep. So it means you can extend this model for the creep, since you will get the same, you are using the same set of internal variables. And then, since these models are easy to couple with finite element parameters, you can also account for local deformations. So what we have done is we use this sample. It's called a head-shaped sample. We deform it in the gliwa. We had the gradient of temperatures and strains. And what we can see is that we can calculate the stresses with the model, which is nice. Everybody likes it. And we can also, here I'm showing a track point of P1, P2, and P3. So you can see the strain evolution, the temperature evolution, the strain rate, and of course the stresses. And you already have noticed that the green point shows very abrupt changes on stresses, for example. And here is where it comes the most interesting part, I think, where it is what happens with this flow localization. So we applied a model where we can calculate the flow localization, or estimate the flow localization. It's a phenomenological model where we have destabilizing parameters, like the effect of strain on the stresses and of temperature on the stresses, and stabilizing like the effect of a strain rate. So the higher the strain rate, the higher the stresses are. And we also use the integrated flow localization parameter. So this is my almost last slide. And this is what you get when you couple everything. You can get the evolution of this flow localization parameter. So strain rate sensitivity is going negative in 0.3, which means something destabilizing is happening. And especially the flow localization parameter on lambda is also going very fast to positive values and to very large values, also showing flow localization there. What is the meaning from the microstructural point of view? The meaning from the microstructural point of view is that you have a very large increment of dislocation densities, that they are only decreased by microstructure evolution, which is in this case the continuous dynamic recrystallization, very localized. And this is what you can see here in the fraction of high angle Green boundaries that goes up very fast. So we can couple and we can understand what happens in this flow localized part. With this, how to apply for steels? Of course, you will need to account for all the mechanical and the phenomenal changes in steels and also dynamic recrystallization in austenite. And this is my last slide. What the models can do is using mesoscale descriptions is to account for dislocation reactions. We need, of course, the constitutive equation, not only for flow stresses, but also for creep strain and strain stress relaxation. We integrate the models in finite element simulations to account for heterogeneities, and we integrate the flow localization to predict damage. The models can describe similar behavior of different alloys, be integrated in finite element simulations to predict microstructures within a workpiece. And we can also predict microstructure after different processing routes, since it's a continuous model. We can also describe the performance of a workpiece based on microstructures, so creep and strength. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to answer your questions.